Good day, dear SBS stakeholders. Welcome to a new edition of Wolves Weekly. Today, my guest is the CEO of Kios, which is a company in the oil industry located in the Republic of Kazakhstan. And the name of my guest is Giuseppe Di Vardo. Giuseppe, a very good day to you.
Very good day to you too, Bert, and very good day to all who's listening to us today.
Thank you very much. You are the CEO of Kios Company. You're Italian citizen living in Kazakhstan for several years, and you're also an SBS alumni with the MBA program.
I had the pleasure of doing that as well, yes.
So the first question I have for you today, Giuseppe, is why are the oil prices so low today? What are the reasons for that?
Well, I would define this mainly in two aspects. That's where I see it from my perspective. One is the declining market case, and the one is the ongoing price war. The declining market basically is just simple the overproduction of concern for a number of oil producers. And this is a slump in the oil price already underway, just got towards, let's say, with the coronavirus period. On 6th of March, in fact, there is some records where we can have some hints. On 6th of March, the 14 member of states of Organization of Oil Production and Exporting Countries, plus the world the second largest producer, Russia, discussed about the possibility of cutting production and stabilizing the declining market. So under the word of declining. Unfortunately, the strategy didn't succeed. And then Russia refused, and there was no agreement, basically. The immediate result on that was the price declined by sudden 8%. The big blow came on 8th of March, when Saudi Aramco, means Saudi Arabia, the major oil producer and one of the major oil producers in the world, maybe still the main oil producer in terms of quantity of production, unilaterally announced that it would increase the production by 1 million barrels per day from 12 to 13 million. The Saudis also announced a price cut between $6 to $8 per barrel. This is the price war. Mm-hmm. This is what started between a few weeks ago, let's say a month ago, between the world, let's say, producers, and created this imbalance and the cut in price. This is where I summarize it the most. There is more to say. It was a beginning of price war. Let's say Moscow is a quick point out and could deal, so they were saying, you know, everyone was saying his own part, that I could manage because anyhow I can produce oil even down to $20 or $22, but is not to be believed because the oil production is not that low as most of things which I can see right now in the nearest market to Kazakhstan, which is Russia, is not so, let's say, true what they're saying, because there are cuts around, are happening cuts of personnel, cuts of contractors, cuts of scope of work. So there is a reduction of that. So it is not so as announced, simple way of simply going down to the price as per that. So basically, I close in two main aspects, decline in market and price war.
Okay. Now, this decline in market, maybe it will pick up again once the coronavirus is over, once the planes start to fly again, everybody starts to drive the car again, then hopefully that will pick up. On the other hand, we know from all marketing textbooks that a price war, there is never a winner. So let's hope that these countries come to an agreement and stabilize the market. Is there enough? Well, if we ask a global question, because people always say, if we look at predictions of the oil exploiting organizations, etc., is there enough oil for, worldwide for the next 20, 30 years? Are there enough reserves?
Well, the outlook says so. The outlook says so, at least up to the year 2050, the outlook says so. There is maybe some more consideration to be done on that, more than if we have or not enough reserve. Let's not forget the shale oil from USA, even though the production is a bit higher than the normal crude oil, but still there are those reserves there, which are in any case one of the contribution into this never-ending discussion between the main producers. But yes, the outlook as on date by the major experts says that till 2050 at least, we will not have much of a condition where there will be a true transition of energy utilization from the oil to the renewable or any other type of utilizable source of energy of utilization. So in that way, I would say yes, it is there in the outlook. We have it, but there are even other considerations to be taken. It depends on the developing parallel part, which is this substitution of energy, which will have to substitute one day. For me, it's quite far there, because we still see a lot of dependence. We are very much still dependent on the oil and the crude oil for many reasons, for all the derivatives, for whatever. We are not ready. We are not ready to switch to a new energy, let's say, era. That's for sure is the case which I see. Because there are, you can say that 60-70% of the world economy nowadays, directly and indirectly, are still tied and dependent to this.
You mentioned before as well the role of OPEC, which is the oil producing and exporting countries organization, which is actually an oligopoly. They determine the price. It's not really the law of supply and demand. Do you think after Corona there will still be OPEC, or is OPEC one of these organizations which will slowly disappear?
But to my opinion, it's quite difficult to say, but to my opinion, there must be a balancing media in between. There should be a judge, right? There should be a way that people are put into a table. They cannot be working independently on this, because everyone will lose ultimately. So it's the interest of everybody to have a common table where they can sit, decide, and strategically think what to do with this outlook, which we just said, which might go up to 2050, even because most of the company nowadays are starting to invest and to look further than 2050, which is the theoretical after which there will be another energy. So they must sit in one table, because we are talking about the world economy, which when there will be a switch, they cannot be doing it alone in any case, because they will depend on each other, or for demand or for the supply. So that has to be for sure controlled somewhere.
Last question I would like to ask, because I don't have the daily opportunity to speak with a specialist. For me, the oil industry, it's a little bit conservative. There is oil, and yes, I cannot imagine that you guys are work on innovations. Are you working on new oil products? And how do I have to see that?
Let's say that in my case, we are a service company, and as a service company, basically we do operate within the oil and gas industry, and we do, just to be down to earth, we do maintenance for the mechanical activities within the oil wells, distribution, maintenance, preventive maintenance. So we are, again, today I have to say, if I have to look at Kios in 2050 after, I would say Kios will close in 2050. If I have to say that Kios should not close in 2050, I have to say what I'm already doing and forcing my shareholders to follow. And it's not easy, because unfortunately, you know, everything got a price, but we have to start to look into it, maybe gradually, proportionally, progressively, but we have to do that. We have to start to switch into renovation, diversification. We have to look and follow the changes which are going to come, because they are going to be there.
Okay. Wonderful. that was the insights from the oil industry with a direct perspective out of Kazakhstan by Mr. De Vardo. Giuseppe, many thanks, mille grazie for your time. I know that you're a busy man, so thank you for this 10 minutes and I wish you continued success.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Bert. Thanks a lot to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.